This is Mother's Day. It is also the Sunday in our worship service in which we invite the women of the church to identify one or two individuals who are selected to be honorary members of the Presbyterian Women's Organization nationally. And so we're delighted for that opportunity this morning. Wednesday night of this week, there is a special program for all adults and children and youth. We will be hearing, of course, the dinner is at 5:30, and then at 6:30, we will be hearing information that is available about Montreat Conference Center. Montreat is our premier Presbyterian Conference Center for the whole nation, and it is only 50 minutes away by car, 55 if you drive the speed limit. But having said that, they have wonderful conferences all through the year, and so we'll be presenting that Wednesday night about what conferences are available for adults and youth. And also, we'll be hearing about Camp Greer and the changes that have been going on there. If you have contributed to the Building Hope campaign, you'll hear an update on Camp Greer about what has changed with the monies that we have raised for that and what are the proposed changes. So encourage all. One of the things we want to do with Camp Greer is to make available to any of our children or youth an opportunity for a scholarship to go to Camp Greer this summer, paying a significant portion of the Camp Greer registration fees. We have this coming week on Saturday two important events that we need help with. We need your help. And Saturday morning, normally we would have about 8 or 10 workers for the Prairie Street Acre of Grace, and I know of 5 of those individuals who are either going to be going to a wedding out of town or are else physically struggling with back injuries or what have you, not because of them working in the Acre of Grace, but the point being is we need some help in the Saturday morning. In the afternoon, starting actually in the morning at 10 a.m., working to 6 p.m., and a portion of that time, if you have an hour or two to spare, we will be receiving food in our pantry from the postal drive. And we need volunteers to help in putting cans from the postal drive. They bring it to the door, and it's our responsibility to get it inside. That usually takes most of the afternoon because that's how long it takes for these different routes to come back with their food. So it'll be 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. If you can contribute an hour or two to that time, that will be a tremendous help to the pantry. And we certainly encourage you to do that. Is Jason with us this morning? Or is someone here to speak about Vacation Bible School? I think Jason is coming, but we're actually a few minutes early, so we'll just go ahead and move on into the service. And if Jason arrives, I'll give him a chance after we do the call to worship to share with you information about Vacation Bible School.
Thank you.
Sarah Seymour has been our guest organist over the last 6 or 7 weeks, and this is her last Sunday to be with us, and we are delighted. Sarah's a senior in high school, and she has done a marvelous job with this, and I'd like for us to thank her for her work with us these past several weeks. Especially if you are parents and your children have grown since you were last in the photo directory. So please be seeing Meredith to update the photos. Jason.
I apologize for being late this morning. In Sunday school, we got hot and heavy into the topic of moral law. Yep, moral law. So Sunday school is a very vibrant thing. We had a great conversation. And that is a good segue into call commission. So, at the end of service, as you're going out, the call commission boards are going to be out in the narthex. As you walk by, look at the ministries that need you to be a part of them. Be in prayer. I've noticed already that we've got some folks who have signed up for ministries that are in need, but I've also noticed that we still have a lot of missing names. A lot of missing names means a lot of missing people. It means a lot of missing opportunities. So be thinking about that. Here at Waldensian, we want you to answer God's call. And we want you to move forward with what God wants us to be. And to do that, you got to commit. Speaking of commitment, I'm going to invite Tamika to come up. She's going to talk about something that's not on our call commission boards, and that is Vacation Bible School.
Just because it's not on the call commission board doesn't mean you can't sign up. You can feel free to let me know. I was called again this year to do Vacation Bible School because spiritually I'm not going to agree to commit myself to do something that is going to annoy me or take my time away from my family or be a burden on my life. So I wouldn't ask any of you to do that either. This year's Bible School is themed towards Joseph, and I don't know how many of you know the story of Joseph, but throughout this curriculum and the journey that we're going to take with Joseph, it's going to teach us the struggles that Joseph had and also the great faith that Joseph had in God throughout. And what I would like to nail down for our kids to take home and for our adults is going to be a sense of relationship. Because I have a relationship with all of you. It's different with each and every one of you, but we all have a relationship together as a church family. But what we're lacking in, and I feel, you know, a lot of churches do, is that connection with the different generations. So what I'm going to charge you guys to do is not to go and say, yes, I will sign up for Bible school because I've done that for 15 years and I'm going to do this job because this is what I've done. I don't really like doing it, but what I want you to do is to pray to God and say, where do I fit in this? Am I going to go to Kevin's Bible study and am I going to worship as an adult and soak myself in the scriptures that are going to be taught? Or am I going to give my gifts to these children and to these adults and to everyone around me by engaging in Bible school this year? So don't be scared. I'm not going to ask all of you to get up and lead a Bible group or do a craft if you don't want to. But what I would like for you to do is to get out of your comfort zone a little bit and be involved in the body of this church so that we can minister to our community and to our children. And thank you in advance.
The Lord God reigns. Let the earth be glad. Let the distant shores rejoice.
Clouds of thick darkness surround God. Righteousness and justice are the foundations of his throne.
God's lightning lights up the world. The earth sees and trembles.
The heavens proclaim God's righteousness, and all people see God's glory.
Light shines on the righteous, and joy on the upright in heart.
Rejoice in the Lord, you who are righteous, and praise God's holy name. Thank you.
favorite action characters? Do you have an action hero that you like?
God, that's good. But there's others, right?
That you see in the store, sometimes you see them at Walmart. But did you know that there are action stories in the Bible? Lots of them. The one I want to tell you about a baby who was born in a very dangerous time. And the amazing things that his Hebrew mommy did to keep him safe. Is today a special day? What is it? It is Mother's Day. So happy Mother's Day to all the mommies today. This Hebrew mommy wanted her little baby boy to have every opportunity to grow and to learn and to be happy. But as her baby grew a little, it was very hard for the mommy to keep him safe. And she was very sad. And so she made a basket. She made a basket like I have here. And she made it out of reeds and tall grass. And then she fed the baby. And she put the baby in the basket. Can you see the baby in the basket? Well, this baby's name is Moses. Poor baby. Already having a rough ride and is not even in the river yet. Okay. Baby's in the basket. And the mother was so sad because she didn't know what was going to happen to baby Moses. And so she prayed as she and her daughter, Miriam, walked down to the Nile River and put the baby in the water. Now this basket she had made very special. She made it so that any water get into the basket, and it was nice and warm because of the blankets. And she was hoping that God would keep the baby safe, baby Moses. And his sister Miriam stayed with the baby, but she hid back in the weeds and the big tall grass. A little later, the princess, who was the king's daughter, came down to the edge of the river to take a bath. How many of you bathe in a river? No one? Well, this princess bathed in the River Nile. And while she was bathing, her friends were all standing around. While she was bathing, she saw something over in the weeds. And she said, "My friend, would you go bring me that thing that I see over there?" What do you think it was? A basket, and you know what's in there, right? But the princess did not know what was in there. But when she opened the basket, she saw a little baby, and the little baby was crying, he was frightened, and the princess was very sad, and then Miriam up to the princess and said, she was kind of nervous. She said, "Princess, would you like for me to go and find a Hebrew lady to keep this baby for you?" And the princess said, "Yes." And do you know who Miriam went to find that to take care of the baby? Anybody know? The baby's mommy. How about that? So the mommy got to take care of the baby. And the princess says, "You feed the baby and take care of the baby, and I will pay you." And after a while, the baby got to be a young boy. And the princess named the baby Moses. And she named him Moses because she said to herself, "I pulled him out of the water, and I named him Moses." Well, this is a special story, isn't it? But it isn't the last story about Moses that you will hear as you grow up in the church. You will hear lots of action stories about Moses. So let's close our eyes and pray. Dear Father, just as the mother of Moses watched over her son and protected him, you love and care for your children. We thank you for your love and protection. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Every Mother's Day, we have the opportunity in the church to honor one or two women of the church who have been faithful servants to this congregation by nominating them and electing them to be in the Women of the Church for our denomination as an honorary life member. So I'd like to call forward the Women of the Church leaders to be able to make that presentation at this time. Meredith and Luke.
Good morning.
Good morning.
On the life member nomination forms, the following was said about our First Lady. She has been a dedicated member of this church since birth. She served as an elder during the very difficult time of church division. She has served on numerous committees, mission, evangelism, and others, a loyal jet-set helper. She is kind, generous, very understanding, and tolerant. Ever loving and respectful toward all people of all faiths. Additionally, she is on the historical committee and involved in museum work, giving tours as needed throughout the year. She fills in at the church office when Rita is away and helps deliver meals on wheels as well as takeouts from church dinners to the homebound. She faithfully attends Sunday schools and church services. Will Wilma Glanon Jones please come forward as I continue with your personal history. Wilma was born in Valdese, the eighth of nine children of Albert and Helen Glanon. She has lived nearly all her life in Valdese. She was a serious student and was frequently listed on the honor roll in both high school and college. She was the first in her family to attend college when she enrolled at Lees McRae. Her youngest brother, Ed, followed in her footsteps at Lees McRae and likes to say that he did well academically by living a Wilma's reputation. She graduated from Lees McRae in 1953 and became a lab tech. It was in college that she met and later married Earl Jones. Her lab career began at Charlotte Memorial Hospital, but as the years passed, she worked in the office of Dr. Fitz and Henry and later on for the Burke County Health Department. She and Earl married in 61, and in 1974, their son Sam was born. She continued to work and with loving child care help from Margaret Glanon and Earl's mother, Mrs. Pikeu, Sam flourished. Wilma retired several years ago and has found more time for her various interests. She and Earl have joined other family members on several road trips, including one through New England and into Nova Scotia. They have also traveled to New Orleans and made a cross-country trip, visiting relatives along the way. Wilma enjoys cooking and often shares a new treat with the neighbors. She has learned to explore the world of internet searches, and because of Sam's work and her travels, has developed a keen interest in Middle Eastern affairs. But the main focus of her life today is Earl, is Sam, and his twin daughters, Faye and Lila. Currently, they live in Florida, but regular Skype calls keep everyone in touch. She changes the sign in front of the church and regularly helps with the jet set meals. Faithfully each month, she pores over the old Valdese newspapers in the museum and comes up with many yesteryear articles which are included in the Jet Set Gazette. She has a giving spirit and does anything anyone asks her. She serves several positions on the Women's Council. She never complains and always has a positive, joyous attitude. Others added, she is active in her church, is Gretchen's right-hand man at the museum, is invaluable on the evangelism committee, and is co-superintendent of Sunday school. Since her identity is most certainly no longer a ministry, Marilyn Leatherman Northrup, please come forward. She married early and is the mother of three sons. The older two, Rich and Rob, live in New England, and the youngest, Mike, lives locally. She has three grandsons, Sam, Caleb, and Nate, and a granddaughter, Anna. She loves preparing little surprise packages for them and only wishes she had more opportunity to spend time with them in person. Marilyn has a talent for and passion about writing. If any of you follow her emails or Facebook, you will have already noted her skill with painting word pictures. Marilyn has had several interesting jobs. While living in Asheville, she worked for J. Crew, taking telephone orders for merchandise. On occasion, she ever even talked to celebrities. More recently, she worked for the Burke County Chamber of Commerce and was a reliable resource when it came to providing phone numbers. You know how hard it is to figure out the phone book when it comes to government agencies. Since her retirement, Marilyn has had more time to devote to reading, cooking, and writing. When it comes to gardening, she recognizes dozens of unusual flowers and trees and loves it when she comes across heirloom seeds to plant.
Thank you.
The marriage yesterday of Sean Powell and Paige Austin. Sean and Paige Powell will be going on. They're staying home today to share Mother's Day with both sets of mothers, and then we'll be going on their honeymoon tomorrow. We had the baptism this morning of Ray Jackson Freeman at the first service, who is the son of Brian and Amy Freeman. Keep in mind also, we don't have anyone in the hospital that I'm aware of this week, or anyone in critical shape, but I want to remember our folks that are in nursing care centers. Benji Peru, Linda Braswell, Billy Britton, Harold Peru, Aggie Burns, Janine Garou, Mary Sherrill, Melanie Grill, Evelyn Benoose, and Claire Demeter are all in several different nursing care centers. So keep them in your loving prayers. Let us now turn to God in prayer. Holy Lord, on this Mother's Day, as we consider the special love that a mother provides for her child, as we consider the love a mother offers to all of her children, we give you thanks, O God, that your love is revealed through mothers. For your love is greater and so profound that it nurtures and provides and protects and challenges and encourages and even at times pushes us out of the nest. All of these things, O Lord, are illustrated in the Bible's understanding that God's love is like a mother's love. So we thank you for this wondrous opportunity that we have this day to celebrate our mothers, for newborn mothers and for expectant mothers as they learn the role of mothering and find that which is second nature to them to come to the surface. We thank you, Lord, for mothers of school-age children and teenagers who direct and provide, who educate and who provide moral leadership for their children. We give you thanks, O God, when mothers recognize it's time for them to leave the nest and to go into the world, to college, or to the workforce and leave home behind. And the pain it causes mothers and children alike. And for the recognition that through that continued love, that the role of a mother continues all their lives. So we pray, Lord, for mothers of adult children who continue on up into their 60s and perhaps even 70s to acknowledge their mother's presence and the important role she plays. We lift before you, God, those individuals in our midst who are mothers who have lost their children to death, for the pain that they experience and that grief that is unmatchable in this world. We ask, O Lord, your comforting presence and guidance to be with those mothers. We lift before you also, God, our church. You have called the church your bride and the bride of Christ. And so we ask you to continue to work through your bride, to serve this world and its people in so many needs, addressing hunger and distress in all kinds of forms. Lord God, renew us as a congregation, as a church, as we faithfully seek to serve you through our pantry, through our garden, through our outreach and education, through being present as a witness of faith in this community. We ask, O God, your blessing upon our sister church in Guatemala. And we ask your will to continue to direct and guide us in all that we do. For we offer this prayer in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Holy God, open us anew, that your word, which is a living word, will find its place in our hearts and in our souls, and give us new life. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. From Acts, the 16th chapter, starting with the 16th verse, listen to the word of God. This is a continuation of the story we started last week, where Paul and Silas and Timothy went into the place of Macedonia. And Paul and Silas together are still in Philippi in the same city, after having converted Lydia to become a worshiper of God in Christ. One day, as we were going to the place of prayer, we met a slave girl who had a spirit of divination and brought her owners a great deal of money by fortune telling. While she followed Paul and us, she would cry out, "These men are slaves of the Most High God, who proclaim to you a way of salvation." She kept doing this for many days, but Paul, very much annoyed, turned and said to the Spirit, "I order you, in the name of Jesus Christ, to come out of her." And it came out that very hour. But when her owners saw that her hope of making money was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace before the authorities. When they had brought them before the magistrates, they said, "These men are disturbing our city. They are Jews and are advocating customs that are not lawful for us as Romans to adopt or observe." The crowd joined in attacking them, and the magistrates had them stripped of their clothing and ordered them to be beaten with rods. And they had given them a severe flogging. Afterwards, they threw them into prison and ordered the jailer to keep them securely. Following these instructions, he put them in the innermost cell and fastened their feet in stocks. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was an earthquake so violent that the foundation of the prisons were shaken. Immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's chains were unfastened. When the jailer woke up and saw the prison doors wide open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, since he supposed that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul shouted with a loud voice, "Do not harm yourself, for we are here." The jailer called for lights, and rushing in, he fell down, trembling before Paul and Silas. Then he brought them outside and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" They answered, "Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved, you and your household." They spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house. At the same hour of the night, he took them and washed their wounds. Then he and his entire family were baptized without delay. He brought them up into the house and set food before them, and he and his entire household rejoiced that he had become a believer in God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So after this long journey last Sunday with Paul and Silas and Timothy from Asia Minor across 450 miles across the Aegean Sea into Philippi, where they are currently staying, after they had baptized Lydia into the faith, they're still in this town, and along comes this young woman who is a seer. A seer in that day and time was a woman who presented oracles of faith to people. In other words, fortune telling, in their understanding of the gods, a pantheon of gods that the Romans worship. But here in this text, she says something very interesting. These two are slaves of the Most High God. There seems to be a major theme of enslavement throughout this whole text. Not only is she a slave to two owners, or several owners, who have put her out to raise money for them, by giving fortune-telling and charging for it, She also then turns and sees that these two are slaves of the Most High God. Enslavement plays a prominent theme in this day's scripture passage. It's very likely that at first these disciples found the announcement that this woman was giving to them. These are slaves of the Most High God! You know, they liked that at first, probably. And day after day of this passes, and after a good long while, Paul is fed up with this woman announcing their arrival wherever they go. He doesn't address her, though. He addresses the spirit that's within her that allows her to be an oracle or a seer. And in announcing and challenging that spirit, he rebukes that spirit to come out of the woman, and then she is left without this ability to prophesy anymore. She's freed, if you will, of her responsibilities to her owners, who no longer can make money and who are upset. One might even assume they might be enslaved to money. But they end up rousing up the crowd and getting them all upset and making everyone direct their attention and focus and their anger towards Paul and Silas, who are severely beaten, stripped, and then put into jail. Yet another form of enslavement. They're locked behind bars. While in jail, recovering from their wounds, it's about midnight, and they are found singing and praying to God. And then an earthquake happens. And in the middle of the earthquake, the jailer falls asleep, and everyone else is freed of their chains. And when he comes to, he realizes, oh my God, everyone is left out of here, and I'm alone, and as the one who's in charge of Roman oversight of these, I will be put to death. He was ready to kill himself over that, for having to face the Roman authorities. But miraculously, Paul and Silas and every one of the other prisoners are still inside, and he hollers out to them, and the guard, sensing the hand of God at work, says, "What must I do to be saved?" The jailer, too, wanted to be freed from a different kind of slavery of his own. As being one who was a servant of Rome, knowing that his charge was now possibly free, he was afraid, and so he realized his life was enslaved. What must I do to be saved? The obvious counter question to that is, saved from what? The jailer wanted to be saved from the wrath of the authorities. But the question has come to mean much, much more to you and I, or to anyone who reads this text. What must I do to be saved from that which destroys my life? So what is it for you? What must I do to be saved from the particular bondage, from my addictive behaviors, from a life devoid of meaning? That is a form of slavery, is it not? If we've ever gone through times of great depression and we think, life, this just isn't worthwhile, that's a form of enslavement. What must I do to be freed from broken and haunting relationships, freed from prevailing sense of hopelessness in my life? All of those are forms of enslavement that we struggle with. There are countless ways, even far more than what I've mentioned. And when we do, we end up in those patterns. We live a life of enslavement, whether we acknowledge it or not. In all these ways, we long for a freedom that we can't provide ourselves. As I read this passage of scripture, my mind went back in time to the summer of 1974, when at the age of 19, I had gone home from college after my freshman year at college. My family had moved the previous year to Columbia, Tennessee from Florida, just after I graduated high school, so I did not know who to contact for summer employment. Plus, I was a week and a half to 2 weeks later than the universities in the state, and so there weren't many jobs left. And I went to the Employment Security Commission, and I sat down with the employment officer, who said, "I do have one job possibility for you here. Would you like to work with a county veterinarian inoculating cattle and other farm animals?" And I said, "You know, that might be interesting." I thought that sounded rather cool, so I set my sight on the directions that she gave me and ended up at the old abandoned county jail with a sign in the front that said Murray County Animal Control Station. By 2 minutes into the interview, I realized I had been baited by that woman at the employment office because I was interviewing to be the county dog catcher's assistant. Oh boy. But knowing that there were no other job prospects available, I reluctantly agreed to take the job. The job came with access to a county truck, and my assignment each morning after watering the animals and feeding them was to go by the county jail and pick up a jail trustee who was assigned to work with me all day on my rounds. I worked with some pretty rough characters over the course of that summer. None of them made a lasting impression upon me except one man. He was in his early 40s, just old enough to be my father. He was as tall as me and about 50 pounds heavier than I was at that 190 teenage body size. His skin was midnight black, and his face and arms were scarred from what I would later come to learn was many a barroom brawl. His name could have come straight out of a William Faulkner Southern novel, Napoleon Solowhite. Loved the man. And all his friends and the jailers in town called him Sally White. Sally White spent the first day sizing me up in the truck as we made our rounds. I shared a little bit about myself to try to break the ice, and by the second day, things were much better. We began to tell stories to each other and talk to each other, and he told me about growing up in a segregated town in the South in the 30s and 40s. Whenever he got serious and told me about his life story, I realized, you know, this is Napoleon. This isn't Sally White talking, so I started calling him by his given name, Napoleon. Later, I learned from him that calling him by his birth name was something not many people did, and he said it helped him to trust me. But Sally White was an alcoholic, the kind of drunk that would change from a gentle giant into a raging bull after a night of sitting and drinking in a barroom stool. He earned all those knife wounds and bruises on his body all too frequently whenever he drank too much. That was the cycle of his enslavement. He would be arrested, do his time, then be released, and I wouldn't see him for several days until he was back on the streets. Then he'd come back in again and work with me again, because he was a trustee. One Monday morning, he was assigned to me in jail. His face was swollen, and he had bandages on one of his arms. He told me, "Kevin, I'm killing myself too young." Over the course of that summer, he was in and out of jail three or four times. One Saturday evening in late July, I get called at home. My mother answers the phone. She said, "There's somebody crying on the phone, and he sounds drunk." So I took it. He said, "It's Sally White." I said, "Napoleon, what's going on?" He said, "I can't get my life straight. Wherever I go, someone always treats me like trash and calls me a nigger. And I always get into trouble. Help me, Kevin," he said. "Pray for me." So I did, on the phone. First time I ever prayed on the phone. And I froze, because I didn't know what to do, what to say, how to help this man, especially when he's drunk. I was in way over my head, but he was a man who trusted me, and yet was so deeply enslaved to alcoholism, racism, and his own angry response to life, and I felt helpless to respond. So after about 30 minutes, eventually I said, "Napoleon, I'm going to hang up now. I'll see you soon." Lo and behold, next Monday, he was back in the truck, and we talked about his troubled life and his violent reaction to life. A few weeks later, my summer job ended, and I returned to college with this haunting memory of a most unlikely friendship with a deeply troubled man whose heart and temperament were beneath all of that were good. Sally White was enslaved. Chances are we all know people in our lives who are enslaved by something. The burdens and distortions of their identity and their lives. And chances are each of us has had a time when we have been ourselves enslaved by something. Where do we turn? What must I do to be saved? It's a universal question. We've all been there. In its simplest form, Paul's answer to the jailer to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ seems at one level to be terribly inadequate and naive, even for us Christians. We recognize that belief in Jesus alone will not solve all the problems that we face, nor will it address all the forms of enslavement that human beings go through. We often think that we need some carefully worded strategic plan or some time-tested method of self-improvement before our lives can be made whole. And at first glance, Paul's answer seems to encourage passivity on our part. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. How can this simplistic, one-size-fits-all answer address our deepest need? But such is the truth of God precisely because Jesus does not offer a program for self-improvement. He offers love. And isn't that at the core of our need to be freed from enslavement in our lives? To be offered the gift of love unconditionally when we can't love ourselves because we're so enslaved. Unconditional love is what Christ offers. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. God is at work reaching out to us through Christ, taking our lives into the gospel story of transformation and redemption. Trusting in this truth means that we first realize there is a difference between problem-solving corrections in our lives that we do need to make, and understanding that first and foremost, we are deeply loved by Christ. And we are ready to learn and grow and change in our lives and to look towards our Savior if we recognize He loves us deeply. So Paul's answer is, yes, simple, but it is not simplistic. It is the grounding of our lives, friends, to recognize our need to be loved by a Creator when we can't love ourselves because we are enslaved to something. All of us have been there. All of us. So we offer gratitude for this answer of Paul's. Don't get me wrong, we still need the counseling. We still struggle every day, even though we know we're loved. We still wrestle with the challenges of our lives, but we're able to face them as Christians because of the underlying truth of who we are, loved children of God. Paul and Silas knew even in jail that their lives were bound to the greater story of God's eternal reign in Jesus Christ. They knew they were loved, which allowed them the confidence in jail, with bodies beaten and bruises, welts on their backs, to continue to pray and sing at midnight. And because of their response to captivity, the jailer realizes that these are the only people who are free, truly free, and yet they're in the stocks in jail with a chance to walk away. They're free to serve and to love God because of their identity in Christ. What must I do to be saved? I invite you to stand and let us affirm our faith as we say the Apostles' Creed, which you will find on page 35 in your hymnal. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Barbie Heilman is going to be leaving, I believe it's Thursday or Saturday of this coming week, going to Malawi, because she has heard the love of Christ at work in her heart, growing her back there. This will be now the second trip for her, but her daughter has been several times as well, both of them. But this is an opportunity now for us to commission her as she goes off on our behalf. And I invite you, friends, to pray for her during her two-week tenure, her time in Malawi. So, Barbie, if you'll come forward. Let's pray. Holy God, we commend Barbie into your loving care, asking that you will guide her and strengthen her as she goes to serve. She brings to the children of Malawi and the hospital at Nakoma our love, and we ask, O God, that our love and your spirit will accompany and guide her in all that she does. Strengthen her and guide her as your servant, and bring her home safely to us. We ask these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Let us offer our gifts of love and gratitude to God.
Thank you.
So whether we are here locally or in Malawi, we ask your blessing upon our lives and these gifts, for we serve you faithfully in Jesus' name. Amen. Same news for other people. In Jesus' name, amen.